It's great play.
Yeah, because all of the, I don't know if it's the buildings blocking the sunlight, but it's just so great. And then you walk a little bit to like St. Paul's Cathedral area, and it's already so much light.
Yeah, the combination of the empty streets and the grey.
Yeah.
Because I lived abroad for 8 years before coming back last summer. From, I was living in Vietnam, you know, where everywhere's so animated and sunny and colourful, and then coming back here into the pandemic, with everyone at home, everyone wearing masks. It was like double culture shock. I worked in the marketing and some different things. There it's got to be. Australia.
this one? Like, as a judge of security. Is that right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
just to let you know for the Mass this evening that singing is now allowed, congregational singing. We ask you please to keep your masks on when you're in the church, but as of Monday, you are now allowed to sing and join in with the hymns, so please do, full voice. Thank you. Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Amen.
Welcome to this celebration of Mass, and welcome to the ordination of Tony, our brother, and all of you, whether family, friends, parishioners, priests, religious sisters, wherever you've come from, the Baylor College, welcome to Forest Gate. And actually, we're nudging out of lockdown. We're singing, we're mixing a little bit more, which is rather nice. And the tropical climate of Forest Gate has calmed down just for today. And that's fine too. In years to come, I will talk about this night particularly because St. Paul boasted occasionally. Do you remember that? He says, I boast. I'm going to boast after today, Tony. Because as I said to him in the sacristy, I've never ordained anybody Antony Jean-Marie Vianney Grant in my life. So when other bishops are there, and I find them rather boring, happens sometimes, I'm going to say, but I ordained Jean-Marie Vianney. Praise be to God. It'll be great. As always, when we begin Mass together, there's that moment of personal reflection, personal honesty between ourselves and Almighty God. So with honesty, with humility, we admit that we're sinners and we turn to the grace of God. We say together, I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary and Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
God, who guided St. Bridget to Sweden along different paths of life and wondrously taught her the wisdom of the cross as she contemplated the passion of your Son, grant us, we pray, that walking worthily in our vocation, we may seek you in all things. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord has been given to me, for the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the poor, to bind up hearts that are broken, to proclaim liberty to captives, freedom to those in prison, to proclaim a year of favor from the Lord, a day of vengeance for our God, to comfort all those who mourn, and to give for them ashes a garland, for mourning robe the oil of gladness, for despondency praise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. I have something to tell your elders. I am an elder myself, and a witness to the sufferings of Christ. And with you I have a share in the glory that is to be revealed. Be the shepherds of the flock of God that is entrusted to you. Watch over it, not simply as a duty, but gladly, because God wants it. Not for sordid money, but because you are eager to do it. Never be a dictator over any group that is put in your charge, but be an example that the whole flock can follow. When the chief shepherd appears, you will be given the crown of unfading glory. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. In the evening of the first day of the week, the doors were closed in the room where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them. He said to them, "Peace be with you," and showed them his hand and his side. The disciples were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. And he said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I am sending you." After saying this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. For those whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. For those whose sins you retain, they are retained." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let Antony John Mary Vianney Grant, who is to be ordained priest, please come forward.
Present. Most Reverend Father, Holy Mother Church asks you to ordain this man, our brother, for service as priest.
Do you judge him to be worthy?
After inquiry among the people of Christ, and upon recommendation of those concerned with his training, I testify that he has been found worthy.
We rely on the help of the Lord God and our Saviour Jesus Christ. We choose this man, our brother, for priesthood in the presbyteral order. In the gospel that Tony has chosen tonight, we have a snapshot of the day of resurrection. Easter Sunday, we hear about the apostles, including, of course, Peter, and we hear about the apostles in shock because Jesus, their rabbi, their teacher, their Lord, had died, had been crucified. And here, 3 days later, they're trying to begin to come to terms with what the resurrection might mean. And we hear lots about Peter in that chapter from St. John. And we know that the events of that day had an enormous effect and dominated the next 40 or 50 days for the apostles. So, for example, when Peter begins to gradually assume his place as the chief of apostles, the rock, there's the question of what to do about Judas, because he's off the scene. And Peter, for the first time, stands, takes his authority, and begins to talk as the shepherd in the image of Jesus, the rock of the church. And interesting what he says to the apostles. He says, we need to choose an apostle, and there's one condition for that apostle. The apostle must be a witness to the resurrection. And so it happened. The lot fell on Matthias. Matthias was a witness to the resurrection. And the first lesson I think we need to just think about tonight is that to be an apostle, to be a helper of the apostles, to be involved in the apostolic ministry, we need to be a witness to the resurrection. And one thing I know about Tony is that he can speak with conviction, with personal conviction, about our Lord Jesus Christ, the crucified and risen Lord, and he, I hope like me, can speak with authority, with conviction, with personal conviction about the resurrection. You and I, Tony, are witnesses to the resurrection. But that first week of Easter, we're thinking, of course, about St. Peter as a young man, you know, and a bit naive, struggling to hold all these things together. And so I was so pleased about your second choice of reading from the New Testament, because it's the letter of St. Peter. And St. Peter is an older man, an experienced man, a man who is very self-consciously a shepherd in the image of the great shepherd of the sheep. He talks again, he takes up this theme. What is it to be an apostle? What is it to be involved in the apostolic ministry, the presbyteral order, the priestly ministry? And there's a slightly different edge this time. He says, I, Peter, am a witness to the sufferings of Christ, the sufferings of Christ. And he's kind of squared the circle, because, of course, Peter, who was the witness to the resurrection, was also the embarrassed, inadequate witness to the sufferings of Christ. I've often thought that whenever poor Peter was a bit cold and wanted to warm himself, whenever he went near a fire, it must have been like a volcano which brought him back to his own denial of Christ around the fire, but also his own encounter with Christ, the risen Lord, when he sees Christ on the beach and the fire cooking the fish and talking to Peter. Do you love me, Peter? Do you love me, Peter? Do you truly love me, Peter? A conversation that had Peter in tears, because of course it all brought back to him completely his denial. The man who denied three times affirmed his love three times for Christ. But the great thing for us is this. By the time St. Peter is nudging towards Rome, nudging towards his own death on the cross, he's maturing into his ministry as the shepherd of the sheep, in the image of the great shepherd of the sheep. As he takes up that authority, lives his priesthood, lives the Christ life, he's also beginning to integrate everything of his life. He knows what it is to be a priest, to be an apostle, to be Peter the rock. And so he can say with great authority, I am a witness to the sufferings and the resurrection of Christ. If you went to Peter, there was no abstract conversation about Christ. There was no notional ideas about philosophy. There was no, well, I suppose, ethereal talk. It was rooted in the life, the suffering, the death, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus Christ, of which Peter is a living witness. And so when we step forward, Tony, for the Presbyteral Order, we're walking into that life, that mindset, that mind frame. And again, it's not just about ideas. All of us here, I hope, can say with Peter, I also want to be a disciple of Christ, a great disciple of Christ, a witness, a personal witness to the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But here's the difference, Tony. Tonight, by laying on of hands, tonight, by the anointing of the Spirit, there's a real difference. Because when St. Peter took up the scroll of Isaiah, and he certainly did, as he'd seen his Lord and Master do that in Nazareth so many years before, the Spirit of the Lord has anointed me. The words of Isaiah became the words of Peter, because the words of Isaiah became the words of Christ. And the words of Isaiah tonight become your words also. And at this point, at an ordination, I actually shiver myself at this point. It's true. Because you are going to talk, to speak, to act in the person of Christ. And what can we say about that? But our faith is this, that by the laying on of hands, by the anointing of the Spirit, this truth, this reality happens. So you are not just a witness to the sufferings, the resurrection of Christ. With Peter, with so many bishops, priests, well, since whenever, 2,000 years, you're going to actually take on the mantle of authority, the mantle of humility, the mantle of being a shepherd. And it's a bit of a frightening thing. But the joy is this. You'll begin to see how this happens, how this works. Most of what you do as a priest, you're preaching, you're administering the sacraments, most of that will be unknown to you. And I often use the little tag sometimes, again in ordinations, hidden and as it were unknown. Ignotus et quasi occultus. In other words, you'll have no idea the people you touch, the people you raise up in the image of Christ. You'll have no idea of the suffering, the death, the resurrection of individuals in Christ that will happen through your hands, through your words. But I guarantee this, Tony, it will happen. It will happen repeatedly. It will happen enormously. And in fact, my guess is this, the greatest thing to do as a priest, you'll have no idea about. You'll have no idea about. So that's the adventure before you. It is an adventure. You are a new priest from this evening, you will be. But there'll be a time like St. Peter when you mature, when you begin to square the circle, when you begin to make sense of all those things that once were separated. For Peter, there was denial. For Peter, there was the cross of Christ. For Peter, there was the resurrection of Christ. For Peter, there was the journey to Rome from Jerusalem. For Peter, there was the increasing understanding, the wisdom of his own ministry as the shepherd of the sheep, the rock in the image of Christ. But for Peter also, there was the martyrdom, the crucifixion outside St. Peter's on the hill. And all of that eventually for Peter made sense, as an older man, as a mature man. So I really do wish you a wonderful priesthood. I wish you wonderful growth in priesthood. One thing I often think about, and with great delight actually, I must say, is the bishop who ordained me is dead. You know, he's gone to his reward. And so many priests I knew who in my day, I suppose, as a younger priest, were great models for me, great examples for me. They've also moved their way. And I actually look forward to moving off the scene from you. I really do, if you can imagine that. That there will be a time when you'll be acting in your priesthood and with your fabulous name, with your wonderful ministry, I think, gosh, I'm so pleased. I'm so delighted. I'll be utterly happy, Tony. I guarantee that. And I wish you much happiness, much joy in your priesthood. And now we move from the personal, I think, to the formal. So I'm going to say a few more words about priesthood, and we can help think about what it is to be a priest. Tony, my son, you are now to be advanced to the order of the presbyterate. You must apply your energies to the duty of teaching in the name of Christ, the chief teacher. Share with all mankind the word of God you have received with joy. Meditate on the law of God. Believe what you read, teach what you believe, and put into practice what you teach. Let the doctrine you teach be true nourishment for the people of God. Let the example of your life attract the followers of Christ, so that by word and action you may build up the house, which is the church of God. In the same way, you must carry out your mission of sanctifying in the power of Christ. Your ministry will perfect the spiritual sacrifice of the faithful by uniting it to Christ's sacrifice, the sacrifice which is offered sacramentally through your hands. Know what you are doing and imitate the mystery you celebrate. In the memorial of the Lord's death and resurrection, make every effort to die to sin and to walk to the new life of Christ. When you baptized, you will bring men and women into the people of God. In the sacrament of penance, you will forgive sins in the name of Christ and the church. With holy oil, you will relieve and console the sick. You will celebrate the liturgy and offer thanks and praise to God throughout the day, praying not only for the people of God, but for the whole world. Remember that you were chosen from among God's people and appointed to act for them in relation to God. Do your part in the work of Christ, the great high priest, with genuine joy and love, and attend to the concerns of Christ always before your own. Finally, conscious sharing of the work of Christ, the head and shepherd of the church, eternal great high priest, and united with the bishop and subject to him, seek to bring the faithful together into a unified family and to lead them effectively through Christ and in the Holy Spirit to God the Father. Always remember the example of the great shepherd of the sheep, the good shepherd, who came not to be served but to serve and to seek out and rescue those who were lost. My son, before you proceed to the order of the presbyterate, declare before the people your intention to undertake the priestly office. Are you resolved, with the help of the Holy Spirit, to discharge without fail the office of priesthood in the presbyteral order as a conscientious fellow worker with the bishops in caring for the Lord's flock?
Aye.
Are you resolved to celebrate the mysteries of Christ faithfully and religiously as the Church has handed them down to us for the glory of God and the sanctification of Christ's people?
Aye.
Are you resolved to exercise the ministry of the word worthily and wisely, preaching the gospel and explaining the Catholic faith?
Aye.
Are you resolved to consecrate your life to God for the salvation of his people, and to unite yourself more closely every day to Christ the High Priest, who offered himself for us to the Father as a perfect sacrifice? Do you promise respect and obedience to me and my successors?
I do.
May God, who has begun the good work in you, bring it to fulfillment.
Let us stand.
My dear people, let us pray that the all-powerful Father may pour out the gifts of heaven on this servant of his, whom he has chosen to be a priest.
Let us kneel.
Pray.
Hear us, Lord our God, and pour out upon this servant of yours the blessing of the Holy Spirit and the grace and the power of the priesthood. In your sight, we offer this man for ordination. Support him with your unfailing love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us stand.
Thank you.
Come to our help, Lord Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. You are the source of every honour and dignity, of all progress and stability. You watch over the growing family of man by your gift of wisdom and your passion of order. When you had appointed high priests to rule your people, you chose other men next to them in rank and dignity to be with them and to help them in their task. And so there grew up the ranks of priests and the offices of Levites established by sacred rites. In the desert, you extended the spirit of Moses to 70 wise men who helped him to rule the great company of his people. You shared among the sons of Aaron the fullness of their father's power to provide worthy priests in sufficient number for the increasing rites of sacrifice and worship. With the same loving care, you gave companions to your sons' apostles to help in teaching the faith. They preached the gospel to the whole world. Lord, grant also to us such fellow workers, for we are weak and our need is greater. Almighty Father, grant to this servant of yours the dignity of the priesthood. Renew within him the spirit of holiness. As a co-worker with the order of bishops, may he be faithful to the ministry that he receives from you, Lord God, and be to others a model of right conduct. May he be faithful in working with the order of bishops, so that the words of the gospel may reach the ends of the earth, and the family of nations, made one in Christ, may become God's one holy people. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God for ever and ever.
Oh.
the Father anointed our Lord Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. May Jesus preserve you to sanctify the Christian people and to offer sacrifice to God. Accept from the holy people of God the gifts to be offered to him. Know what you are doing and imitate the mystery you celebrate. Model your life on the mystery of the Lord's cross. pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Most merciful God, who were pleased to create in St. Bridget the new man in your own image, the old having passed away, graciously grant, we pray, the renewed like her, we may offer you the acceptable sacrifice of conciliation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, you made your only begotten Son, High Priest of the new and eternal covenant. And by your wondrous design, we're pleased to decree that his one priesthood should continue in the Church. For Christ not only adorns with a royal priesthood the people he has made his own, but with a brother's kindness, he also chooses men to become sharers in his sacred ministry through the laying on of hands. They are to renew in his name the sacrifice of human redemption, to set before your children the pastoral banquet, to lead your holy people in charity, to nourish them with the word of God and strengthen them with the sacraments. As they give up their lives for you and for the salvation of their brothers and sisters, they strive to be conformed to the image of Christ himself and offer you a constant witness of faith and love. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. Most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your Holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant, Francis, our Pope, may your unworthy servant, and all those who are holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith.
Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement and Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help.
Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you also for this your servant, whom you've been pleased to raise to the order of priesthood, and in your mercy keep safe your gifts in him, so that what he's received by divine commission he may fulfill by divine assistance. Be pleased, O Lord, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as one should please to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace.
To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. As we wait, bless, hope, and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and glory of
God. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not in our sins, put on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Oh.
Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we who are fortified by the power of this sacrament may learn through the example of St. Bridget, seek you always above all things, and to bear in this world the likeness of the new man through Christ our Lord.
Amen. So, my dear brothers, just very quickly, I just want to say a few words. First of all, huge congratulations to Tony, and he knows how deeply he is loved by everybody here gathering tonight, and loved by everybody here in St. Anthony's as well. I see a large delegation of Durning Hall here as well. There's different layers of love here present tonight. So, and we keep you, Tony, obviously, in our prayers, and we ask the Lord to bless your ministry. I want to say a huge thanks as well to everybody who participated in the liturgy tonight, making it successful, and for Bishop Allen being present here, and the priests and deacons from far and wide, for our beautiful choirs making the liturgy tonight so uplifting and prayerful, and for Father Mark's hard work and the MCs behind the scenes, the servers, the readers, all who participated in making this liturgy tonight prayerful and open to the Spirit of God. I want to thank as well everybody who brought food, and a huge thanks as well to St. Bonaventure School, who have been so cooperative and helpful and supportive, Tony being a former bonds boy, so it's also a beautiful blessing to have. And thanks to all those who brought drinks and water and beer and the whole shebang, everything that's there in St. Francis Hall, thank you so much. And after the Mass, I'd like to invite you to go up Lancaster Road. Unless you're not very mobile, you can go through there, but I don't want to make a bottleneck given the situation we're in at the moment. Just if you can at all walk around Lancaster Road and come through the gate, that would help. And we will gather to celebrate together on the Friary Lawn this Son of God, who has just received the gift of priesthood. So follow the guidance of the stewards, and thank you all again for being present tonight.
Thank you, Father John Jesus, also to the community for the great welcome we always receive here. I was just reflecting as you were talking that when I was ordained 38 years ago in Whitechapel, the parish did a wonderful buffet, and I did the blessings, and when I got there, not a scrap was left. Nothing at all. And of course, being a rather naive new priest, I hadn't had breakfast. I'm sure you've not only got food inside of you, but you've also got a great parish. We'll leave you something. Okay, we guarantee. Let's stand for the final blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down for the blessing.
May God, who founded the church and guides her still, protect you constantly with his grace, that you may faithfully discharge the duties of the priesthood.
Amen.
May he make you a servant and a witness in the world to divine charity and truth, and a faithful minister of reconciliation.
Amen.
And may he make you a true shepherd to provide the living bread and the word of life to the faithful, that they may continue to grow in the unity of the body of Christ.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you who are gathered here, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
St. Jean Marie Vianney.
Remember the food from that occasion, it's amazing.
Yeah, I remember the flavour of the turtle. It was a pretty hot dough, so it's
exactly the same.
Okay, that's
what is it?
June.
Basil Hume. That's it, yes. I want to play for him for something. And he said after Zoe, he said your play is pleasant. Your play is very pleasant. I thought, well, it's from a cardinal, so I'll take it.
He was accustomed to the drawing, so I think we're doing okay.
I love James. That's fantastic.
Get a full brass band. And half the drone back.
There's that on YouTube. There's a clip of when the Pope came to London.
It's the Tours Petrus. It's insane.
And it is. You know, you think, is this just a step? Is this a step too far? Do you know the piece we're talking about? The Pope came to London, and there's this piece with chant, all the organs, and there's timpani. It's almost not
normal. And this world. You get tenors screaming top hands. It's hilarious. It's very entertaining.
Was it good top hands?
Yes, because it's okay. It's as close as bad they get. It still sounds incredible, but it's still the closest to bad they get. It's worth a listen.
I don't know about you, but I could murder a glass of wine. So, time for it.
Yeah.
Thanks, and thanks for doing the Litany of Saints at the last.
I hope you like my inflection on Saint Patrick. Saint Anne.
Oh yeah.
I caught your eye. There was a few eyebrows.
I
slightly felt this sort of, you know, St. Antony.
And all
holy men and women.
One, you should. Yeah. Place where we've done some stuff, and you just, and then he goes, in benediction, blessed be God, blessed be say, blessed be, blessed the last one, blessed with extra allowance. I was channeling Father Owen.
Why not? Good.
Well, very good singing, you all.
Thank you. Nice to meet
you.
Do you know
the thing is they can really see it, which is nice to really just know if that was good.